Good afternoon, Jeff Hogan.
Hello, good afternoon.
Many Cameroon people know you through the channel which is called Net Geo. And today I'm very happy to see you. And I used to know your program on Net Geo channel that is called Monster Fish. And then I saw another program that is called Wonder of Mekong. And you are here in Cambodia, and you are in the Mekong River here in Cambodia. And why you do that program? I mean, why Wonder of Mekong? And what are wonder in the Mekong here when you are in the Mekong, specifically in Cambodia?
Yeah, thank you. So I started working with Nat Geo about 15 years ago. And when I first started working with National Geographic, I started out working in Cambodia, in the Mekong. And we started doing the television show you were talking about. So we did the television show Monster Fish and traveled all around the world to all the different places that have big fish, amazing fish. And we've come to Cambodia 2 or 3 times to film fish in Cambodia. And through my work with National Geographic, through my work with the TV show Monster Fish, my work at the university, I'm a fish biologist. Oh. I learn more about the Mekong and what a special place it is, what a special place the Mekong is in Cambodia, and how many fish there are in Cambodia. So the Wonders of the Mekong project is a new project. We just started it this year, and it's focused on all of the amazing things about the Mekong River, especially in Cambodia. So the diversity of fish, you know, almost 1,000 different kinds of fish in the Mekong River. Fisheries production, so millions of tons of fish that are coming from the river every year. And all Cambodians eat fish, they're used to eating fish, having fish soup every day, so fish is very important here. All of the different biodiversity, the culture, like Angkor, that's based on life living around the Mekong and around the lake. So the Wonders of the Mekong project is focused on the many values of a healthy Mekong River.
And how many stories have you covered already in the Mekong, specifically in Cambodia?
So I've worked in Cambodia since about 2000, so almost 20 years. And I started working with Fisheries Administration, Ministry of Environment, about 20 years ago, and with National Geographic. Mm-hmm. For our show, we've done 1, 2, 3 different programs in Cambodia. So we did one show on giant stingray. I could share some photos with you. Giant stingray. One show on giant...
The biggest fish in the Mekong?
So the biggest fish in the Mekong is giant Mekong catfish. So it's a catfish that gets up to about 10 feet long, about 3 meters long, that's caught right outside of Phnom Penh. Very, very, the biggest freshwater fish in the world is caught just outside of Phnom Penh. And then also a fish that most people know.
And what is it weight?
About 600 pounds, so 300 kilos.
You catch in Phnom Penh?
Just outside of Phnom Penh, yeah.
Near
the Japanese bridge.
Really?
Yeah.
And you catch it and then you release it? Or?
Well, so the fishermen, Cambodian fishermen, catch it. We have a program through Fisheries Administration. We work with the fishermen. When they catch the giant catfish, we do some research and then we release the fish back into the river. Mm-hmm. So we've been doing that now for about 15 years. And with a partnership with Fisheries Administration and fishermen. And we have that program to study the fish and also to to conserve them.
Okay, so back to your program, Wonder of Mekong. So the fish is wonder, or maybe there are another thing that is one more wonder than fish, for example, culture, temple, or what else?
Yeah, so there are many wonders of the Mekong. The Mekong, it has very high biodiversity, so many different kinds of animals. It's a very productive system. So people here might not realize, but Cambodians eat more fish. They get more fish from the river than almost people in almost any other country on earth. There are more fish, more different kinds of fish here in Cambodia than almost any other place on earth.
You mean Cambodian people eat more fish than other people on the earth?
Yeah. So Cambodian people eat more fish than almost any other country.
Can you tell me, for example, each person eat how many kilogram of fish per year or per day or per month?
I think around 50 kilos per year. How many kilos of fish do you eat a year? Do you know?
I don't know.
Well, on average, Cambodians eat about between 30 and 60 kilos of fish a year, which is a lot.
Like compared to other countries.
Yeah, compared to other countries.
For example, in US, in your country, how many kilograms do people eat per year?
I'm not sure, but maybe like 5 or 10 kilos. Compared to Cambodia, it might be 30, 60 kilos. So Cambodian people might be eating 10 times more fish than some people in America.
So American people eat more meat
than other fish? Other kinds of, like chicken, beef, pork. So when we come to Cambodia, I think everyone, for some foreigners, they come to Cambodia, fish soup is very common here. But like in the US, we don't have fish soup. So we can see immediately, you go to a restaurant, you have fish soup, grilled fish, prahok, all different kinds of fish.
You like prahok, fermented fish, or you don't like at all?
I don't like prahok.
it smells strongly?
Yeah. So I work with the fishermen a lot, and we go out on the river, we see the fishermen making prahok in the old way. They cut the head off, they take the scales off, they step on the fish to clean the fish, and then they put the fish in the jar, add salt, and then it ferments. So I like watching people make prahok. I don't like the taste of prahok. The smell is quite strong.
Okay, so you are talking about Mekong, but for Cambodian people, Mekong is one thing, but Tonle Sap is another thing. I mean, Tonle Sap is the big lake, or maybe the biggest lake in Asia, something like that. So my question to you is that there are more fish in the Mekong, or there are more fish in Tonle Sap?
Yeah, that's a good question. So there are over 100,000 tons of fish caught every year in the Tonle Sap Lake. And there are also probably around that same amount caught from the Mekong. Tens of thousands of tons from the Mekong. The most important thing for me to explain is that the Mekong, people think maybe the Mekong, the Tonle Sap are different. But they're not different. They're connected. And so you have the Mekong flowing down in the rainy season now. The water flows up the Tonle Sap River right by Phnom Penh and then flows into the lake. And that system is all connected. If you cut the connection from the Mekong River and the Tonle Sap, then the fishery will collapse. So the Mekong and the Tonle Sap are actually, they're connected. You know, like one arm of us with the other arm, or our heart and our lungs. So maybe the heart is the Mekong, the lungs are Tonle Sap.
You mean both of them are very important. They need each other. They cannot like cut one from another.
Exactly, yeah. So the Tonle Sap and the Mekong are very closely connected, and they can't exist one without the other.
If I'm talking about landscape, between Mekong and Tonle Sap, which one do you prefer, for example?
The Tonle Sap is unique. There's really no other place like it in the world. So the Tonle Sap River changes direction. In the dry season, it's flowing out to the Mekong. In the rainy season, it flows from the Mekong up into the Tonle Sap Lake. That's very unusual. There's almost no river like that on Earth. So it's very, very unique. The Mekong is unique. Some places in the Mekong River have pools that are 80 meters deep. 80 meters, very, very deep pools. And we also have animals like freshwater dolphins. So in the Mekong, you have a population near Krache of dolphins that live in freshwater. So they're both the Tonle Sap and Mekong are very unique places.
You mean in the Krache, that zone, the deepest zone in the Mekong in Cambodia, or what? 80 meters.
80, yeah. So very deep holes around Stung Treng, around Krache. Very, very deep water. So when you look at the Mekong, you can't tell how deep it is. But in some places, it's very, very deep. And some of those...
You mean the deepest zone of the Mekong, because the Mekong is very long from China through Burma, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, and to Vietnam. And when you say, when you mention the deepest, it means the deepest point spot of the Mekong? Or?
Spots, yeah. Specific places, deep pools. And a lot of times these very deep pools, it might be where very big fish live. So it's they're special places.
So the deepest zone, I mean the deepest zone of the Mekong,
yeah,
compared to Laos or to Thailand, or so?
So the deepest places in the Mekong are in Laos and Cambodia. So there are some deep pools in Laos, also some very deep pools in Cambodia. If you go up to Stung Treng and Krache, you see all the rocks. Sometimes you can see rapids. And underneath the water, some of those pools are 50 or 60 meters deep.
So talking about fish of Cambodia, I mean in Cambodia specifically, what kind of fish that you like the most? For example, catfish or maybe another kind of fish?
Mm-hmm. Cambodia and the Mekong have more species of giant fish. I like giant fish. More species of giant fish than any other river in the world. So of the giant fish, there's Mekong giant catfish. Catfish that can get up to about 3 meters and 300 kilos. There is giant freshwater stingray. Mm. So a stingray that's about 5 meters long that lives in freshwater. Mm-hmm. There are seven striped barb. So a big carp that has stripes, seven stripes along its body that gets up to about 100 kilos. And then also there's giant barb. It's a national fish of Cambodia. Has a big head, big lips, big scales, like scales about the same size as my hand.
Yeah.
It gets up to 200 or 250 kilos. Those are my favorite, biggest ones.
Okay, but the fish that you told me just now still have in the Mekong, or maybe they all disappear, for example? Because Cambodian people say that the big fish in Cambodia now disappear already because fishermen fish them nearly all. Is it correct?
So almost these big fish are almost gone. And one of the purposes of our project is to try to help the populations of these fish and people who depend on fish. So we want to try to make sure that these big fish don't disappear entirely. They're still there. They're still in the river, but they're very, very rare. So we want to make sure they don't disappear.
But how to save them?
Well,
your project, for example.
Yeah, so one way is to keep some places of the Mekong healthy. So for example, in Prek Tual, in the Tonle Sap Lake, it's a national park, or it's a protected area with beautiful flooded forests. It's a good place for fish to grow big. Up in near the dolphin area in Krache, that area also has some protection, keep it protected for dolphins and for fish. So we need to keep a few places in the Mekong healthy and pristine, and then those big fish and other animals can survive.
And any budget to implement that project to save fish in danger, or you don't have, or you are seeking the fund now?
Well, so we have funding. This project is supported by USAID, and it's in partnership with the University of Nevada in the US, that's where I work, and also with the Fisheries Administration. And so we plan to continue this project for 5 years. We're just starting now, but we'll build programs, research programs, training programs, education programs, and media to try to increase protection of the Mekong.
You mentioned already about the beauty of the Mekong, beauty of the Tonle Sap Lake, but some people said that Mekong and Tonle Sap are in danger. What do you interpret that?
Well, the Mekong and the Tonle Sap are endangered and beautiful. I mean, they're both. For example, last year, so you have the flooded forest in the Tonle Sap Lake. And if you've ever been to the flooded forest, it looks a little bit like this. You can take a boat into the forest. You have the trees above you in the lake. It's very beautiful. It's a very beautiful place. Lots of birds, big water birds. It's a very beautiful place. But last year, because of the drought, there were also a lot of fires in the Tonle Sap Lake. So a lot of the forest was destroyed. So it's, you have these beautiful areas, but they are also under threat. So we try to work with other partners, with the Cambodian government, to try to find some strategies to protect the beauty of the Mekong River.
Of the Mekong River. Yeah.
And the Tonle Sap. So when I say Mekong River, I'm also talking about the Tonle Sap, because in my mind, it's all connected.
Okay, when you are talking about Tonle Sap, I want to know, I know that maybe you know well Amazon. Between Amazon River and Tonle Sap River, which one is the best for you? Maybe, I don't know, in terms of beauty, in terms of natural resources, something like that. So can you tell me a little bit more, please?
So I think that the Mekong River is the most important river in the whole world, the most important river on Earth. And that's partially because so many people depend on the Mekong to survive. Also because there are a lot of threats to the Mekong right now, so we need to work hard to try to protect the Mekong. And then lastly, there are so many different kinds of fish and animals that depend on the Mekong River. So in my mind, because of the people that depend on the river, the threats and all of the biodiversity, it makes the Mekong the most important river on Earth.
So compared to Amazon, for example, which one? because I don't know Amazon and you know well.
Well, so the Amazon is bigger than the Mekong. There actually are more different kinds of animals and more different kinds of fish in the Amazon. But here in the Mekong, what makes the Mekong so special is how many people there are. There's so many people in this region and so many people that depend on the Mekong. And you have, for example, Angkor Wat, Greater Angkor. That's a civilization here in Cambodia that was dependent on the lake and all of the fish and all the wildlife of the lake 1,000 years ago. So a whole huge civilization 1,000 years ago that was dependent on all of the richness and resources of the Mekong and the Tonle Sap.
We often saw you on Nat Geo channel and you catch fish, big fish. And have you, do the fish, no, have the fish ever by you, for example?
A lot of people, when they see the show, some of the fish look very dangerous. A lot of the fish that we work with, they have big teeth. Some of them have sharp spines. Sometimes we work with sharks. You know, obviously sharks can bite. Most of these fish are not dangerous. I always tell people, you know, don't be afraid to go in the water. If you catch a really big fish, then maybe you should be a little bit careful, because the big fish are really powerful, but we've never had too many problems. One time when our cameraman was filming, he was shocked by an electric eel, by an electric fish. So he got a shock and he fell into the water. But then we pulled him out, he was okay. Some other people we work with have gotten bitten. Like when we work with sharks, they get shark bites. The Amazon fish, they'll jump, and sometimes they'll jump and hit you with their head. You can get a bruise or something. So you have to be careful, but we haven't had any big problems.
So you were not hit by the fish?
Just some cuts sometimes, you know, small cuts. We actually were doing a program last month in Myanmar, and you can still see. So I have some cuts on my hands, just small cuts. Not big.
But you don't work only in Cambodia. You work in Thailand, in Mekong, in Thailand, in Burma, in Laos, in Vietnam, or China too.
The focus is Cambodia, but I work all over the world. Yeah, okay. Cambodia, also other countries of the Mekong, and all over the world. But I like to come back to Cambodia because fish and the river and water are very important to Cambodia.
I know that you are marine biologist. You like fish. So you like saving fish or you like eating fish?
I like saving fish.
So you don't eat a lot?
I eat some fish, but mainly for me, I think of fish as very beautiful, and I mainly work to conserve fish.
So you respect them, like Indian people respect your beef?
Yeah, so I respect fish.
Your story are done. I mean your story about Wanda Mekong and Dan, and then how to promote that story. You will work with any media outlet in Cambodia? Yeah, can you tell me?
Well, so as we continue the project, we'll be uncovering interesting stories about the Mekong. And so we would like to share those stories with people in Cambodia. We'll share those stories with you.
With my online news. When will we start?
Well, so we're going to start producing stories now. Mm-hmm. And every month or so, we'll feature a new story, new interesting story about the Mekong, and we'll share it with Tamay Tamay.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.